Sid Rosenberg Show.
From bad, bad, bad to good into 2015 here and beyond, let's not forget to give credit to the guy that all Mets fans seemingly wanted out the door, and all Mets fans said he destroyed our farm system and our baseball team. That, of course, would be the GM before Sandy Alderson, Omar Minaya. When he was here, the Mets went for it. They signed big free agents. They lost picks. They were more of a big market team, spending money, going after Delgado, going after Pedro Martinez, going after Carlos Beltran to pair with a young Reyes and a young Wright. Santana came in. The Mets were big spenders in that time, and the Mets were a very good team on the verge of something very special in 06, 07, and 08. It all crumbled. The Mets farm system crumbled, or so we thought, under Omar Minaya. When he left, 2010, Baseball America rated the Mets farm system the sixth worst in Major League Baseball. Well, you look up now, what do you know? 12 members, basically half of the Mets, drafted or signed by Omar Minaya before he left office. Of course, Matt Harvey, part of that contingent. Jacob DeGrom. So half of the Mets rotation and three-fifths, 60% of its future, drafted or brought in by Omar Minaya. Don't forget Jerry's Familia at the end of games, closing games out. Lucas Duda at first base. Juan Lagares, Wilmer Flores. All of those guys either signed or drafted by Omar Minaya. So as you watch the Mets here, as you get all excited about their future and the future of the pitching rotation, some of that, yes, no doubt about it, has to be because of what Sandy Alderson did. But let's not also forget, who did Sandy Alderson trade to get those guys? Beltran to get Wheeler. He traded Dickey to go get d'Arnaud and Syndergaard. And guess what? Those guys, of course, also brought in by Omar Minaya. As the Mets come back to relevance here, let's give a little credit.
We walked on the beach beside that old hotel. They're tearing it down now, but it's just as well. I haven't shown you everything a man can do. So stay with me, baby. I got plans for you. This is the time to remember, 'cause it will not last forever. These are the days to hold on to, 'cause we won't, although we'll want to.
Where the hell did you find that piece?
NJ.com, New Jersey.
Yeah, yeah, they do a lot of Yankee
stuff.
They do,
yeah, some videos and stuff. And that
well, listen, I know Omar Minaya very well because when I was a star, and I was a star, I know it sounds hard to believe, but I really was, and a huge star on the rise in New York working at the Fan, and at that time the Fan still had the Mets. 2 years ago they switched to the Yankees. Omar was a GM of the Mets, so I was there on a cold, blistery February day for the Carlos Beltran press conference and for the Pedro Martinez press conference, and Omar came on with me and Beningo and all the guys quite a bit, was always a stand-up guy. He got his ass kicked up there. And as that piece pointed out, even the Mets now, getting ready for the Dodgers on Friday, is Omar's team. And you could talk about Cespedes and Clippert and the moves that Alderson made, but that was a great piece. Omar Minaya deserves a ton of credit.
Yeah, even more than a ton of credit. And one thing that wasn't mentioned there, I remember Mets fans, we had a young third baseman prospect named David Wright, and at the time playing third base was Ty Wigginton.
The great Ty Wigginton,
who
yes.
was having he was having a good year at a couple good seasons.
That's all.
People were saying to trade David Wright because he was unproven and go with the proven Ty Wigginton.
Right.
How did that work out? Ty Wigginton became an average utility player.
That's
and
all.
We know about David Wright.
We know about David Wright. So quickly, before I bring Omar on, it's going to be great that I miss Omar. It'd be nice to talk to him. Give me the names. So Matt Harvey, Jacob DeGrom, Familia, Lucas Duda, Juan Lagares, Wilmer Flores. These are all Omar Minaya guys.
And then the pieces, like they said, some of the trading pieces that they used.
Right. Beltran.
I mean, yeah, Beltran to get Wheeler. Wheeler's part of the future, big part of the future.
R.A. Dickey. To get d'Arnaud
and Syndergaard.
And Syndergaard,
Syndergaard
yeah.
will be pitching game two in L.A., d'Arnaud behind the plate.
Jesus Christ,
this
Omar
is his
Minaya,
team.
He's a god. Omar Minaya, I got to tell you, I am going to apologize right now, Omar, for all the guys that I worked with, excluding me, of course, and Mike and the Mad Dog and every other jerk up there in New York who gave you a hard time. It's obvious you've done an amazing job with this Met team, even 5 years later, Omar.
Well, guys, it's great to be with you. And first of all, thank you for all those praises, even though I'm not the type of person that likes to hear it. You know, it's not about Omar Minaya. It's really about the whole organization and everybody else. But it is good talking to you again. As you said, we go way back to those early days in New York with the Mets. And I'm happy to hear you guys are seem to be doing very well. The introduction is very creative, and I can just say those listeners in Florida are probably every day have a lot of fun on their way to work.
Thank you. It's funny. What I've done, Omar, basically is listen. I know one thing. When you were in New York, and the fan, of course, had the Mets. They had Imus. We had Imus in the morning, you know. So Imus, of course, was into news and politics. And then we had guys like me and Mike and the Mad Dog, all the sportsy, jerky guys. And what I've done in the last couple of years down here, Omar, is I've kind of incorporated the news and the politics, like Imus would do, with the energy, with the sports, with a New York style in South Florida. And that's basically become my show. So in a four-hour period every morning, Omar, you get everything from Donald Trump to Kim Kardashian, to David Wright.
Hey, look, when you're driving or when you're just starting the day, you need to laugh a little, you need to think a little, and
right.
I'm pretty sure you're providing those two those areas for the listeners. And I'm excited, like I said, first of all, happy for you.
Thank you.
You know that, and happy for your listeners. But look,
you're a good guy. You're a good guy. When you say that, I know when you say that you're sincere. You're a good guy. And look, I know you're a humble guy too, Omar. So you're going to say, look, it's not about me, and I don't care. But look, let's be honest, okay? When you're going well in New York, you're a king. As you know, right before, Beltran struck out against Adam Wainwright. But once you lose a 7-game lead over 17 games, you become a villain very, very quickly. And they don't just treat you poorly in New York when things go badly. They go over the top. And listen, I was part of it. It's not fair. It gets really, really bad. And so even though you're going to be humble and say the right things about it now, truth is, on the way out, they kicked you pretty hard in the ass. There's got to be a little bit of satisfaction that you've really put together this team who's now driving into the playoffs.
Well, I think the satisfaction is that you feel you know, and I use the word small part of something that hopefully that looks pretty good right now. And for those of us that work in baseball and those that are in baseball, we understand that this is a process and it takes time and everybody puts in a little in that. Look, at the end of the day, it's really about the players. I always go back to the scouts and the development people. And the end product is an unbelievable, great job that has been done by the current front office from Sandy Alston, Paul DePodesta, and the ownership that went out there and invested. So it's always a group effort. Everybody knows that. And, you know, understanding that, you know, you feel fortunate that you were a part of it, a small part of it, because some of these guys you're starting. But look, I can tell you right now, right down there in Florida, I believe the instructional league is going. And you have a lot of those coaches and scouts that are working down in Port St. Lucie that are really are the backbone of making sure that that game we're going to see this weekend. Those guys are the backbone, and I've never lost sight of that, even as a general manager. And of course, as you said about New York, being a New Yorker that I have been my whole life, you know, when you marry jobs, you know it. If you win, you're great. If you don't, and that's just the way it is. So when you marry these jobs, you know that's part of the program.
No, you took it well. Omar Minaya, the former GM of the Mets and Expos, and has had success all over Major League Baseball. Also, by the way, the first Hispanic GM ever, which is a very, 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 very big deal. And I do want to thank Peter Kramer from Mateo's Restaurant in East Boca. Peter's a guy that set this up with Omar. He's a big Met fan. And, you know, Omar, listen, I was there. It was Shea Stadium back then. It's always going to be Shea for me. On that cold day when
I agree. It's still Shea for me also.
Always. You remember the Carlos Beltran press conference was a miserable cold day. I was there for the Pedro press conference, and you sat down with me and Beningo. So at that time, you know, you were bringing in, you brought in Santa, you brought in a lot of high-priced veterans. And to your credit, when there was a big name on the free agent market back then, you got those guys, and the Mets did have very good success until the very end of 2006.
Yeah, you're right. No, look, when we put a program in place, when I came in there for the 2005 season, it was a program that we wanted to be relevant. We wanted to get to the playoffs. We wanted to win a lot of games. We wanted to fill the stadium. we did all those things. And, of course, we did go to the championship game, National League championship game in 06. But the fans was up, the ratings was up. All those things were, it was at a cost, there's no doubt. When you do those things, when you sign free agents, you have to give up your draft picks. So that's the void, and of course that. But that being said, we felt comfortable that the scouts were going to fill in the gaps, which is what proven to be true.
Yeah.
But that being said, like you said before, when you're up 17, when you're up 7 with 17 to go, and you give it away, and then the next year you go to the last game again, that is tough in a big market like New York, and that's just the reality.
That was a killer. Look, one thing about you, Omar, is you don't need to defend yourself. You've had a great baseball career, and again, the Mets right now, evidence of that. But I think you're the type of guy that would admit when you make a mistake. Now, it's always easy to say you make a mistake afterwards, but two contracts specifically when I was working in New York that you took a beating for, Oliver Perez, first of all, and the other was Jason Bay. Jason Bay was a really good baseball player, and then he got to the Mets, and he wasn't. But there was no way you were going to know that. But thinking back about some of these deals, are there some you wish you really hadn't done?
Oh, of course. Everybody thinks like that, you know. But, look, that's every time when you're in the free agent market, all these deals are not going to work out. But that's just the way it is. That's just when you are afraid to make moves because they're going to go bad, you're never going to win. When you win, people forget about the bad moves. And for every move that there's a, you know, an Oliver Perez that didn't produce the way we thought he could produce, rotation, you know, then you have those, the R.A. Dickey, and those that you pay little and they give you great production. But and look, we know that when you lose, the ones that are going to get highlighted are the bad ones. And when you win, and even when you win, you got teams that are winning right now that have some real bad deals. But that's just the way it is, and you know. But you cannot, you know, if you have a mind of providing the best product for the fan base and trying to win, and in a big market like New York, you understand you will take the hit. But you do it because you feel like you want to give the fans the best team and the most excitement possible.
Let's talk about this team right now. Omar, the great Omar Minaya, Mets and Dodgers start their best of five Friday night late. It'll be DeGrom. You sign him up against Clayton Kershaw. Just for the fans out there that don't even know really what you do on a day-to-day basis, how old are some of these kids, Matt Harvey, Jacob DeGrom, when you first see them, and then when you sign them, on average, how old are these kids?
Most of the times, if they're high school kids, they're somewhere between 17 and 18.
Wow.
If they're college kids, they're looking at somewhere between 20 and 21. Some of those kids, like Harvey, was a college kid. DeGrom was a college kid. So those kids are coming into what we call the major league, or the system, somewhere in the late teens or early 20s. And then, of course, it takes some time. It takes some time. There's a kid like Steven Matz, who's going to be probably pitching game four, who we drafted from Long Island, who's, I believe we signed him at 17, maybe 18. And for the first 2 years, he really didn't even pitch because of injuries. And he's a real good-looking kid. So, and that's a credit, really, like I said, back to those development people, medical people, the development people that were patient and the medical people that get these guys on the field. It's a long process, you know. I know that a lot of people follow the drafts as far as football and basketball, and those drafts can be evaluated within a year, sometimes within a couple of months.
Right.
But in baseball, it's totally different.
Well, tell me about DeGrom for a second, because a lot of people believe he's now gone past Matt Harvey, and he's the best pitcher on the Mets. He won the Rookie of the Year last year for about 4.5 months. This year, he was as good as anybody. He kind of tailed off at the very end, but no one had any idea about him. You know, last year, before he became a big-time star, we were talking about Montero and Syndergaard and everybody but Jacob DeGrom, and now he's a legitimate star. He's pitching game one. What did you think, honestly, Jacob DeGrom was going to be?
Well, you know, look, I believe he was taken in the eighth round. I believe we took him in the eighth and ninth round in that range. So, first of all, you couldn't think that he is what he is today.
Right.
Because you would have taken him earlier.
Right. Fair enough.
So, that being said, you knew that you were signing an athlete. He was a converted guy. He played shortstop with a real good arm. and our area scout and our scouting our scouting director Rudy Terrasas, and then really liked what they saw his potential to be as a good athlete with a good arm. And then, of course, once he comes into the system, he himself got hurt, and then the development people, get in involved. But we thought he had a chance to have a good arm, to be somewhere a starting pitcher. Nobody could tell you they thought he was going to be a number one,
right?
Because if you would have thought he was number one, you say, well, why didn't you take him in the first round?
Sure.
So long?
Yeah. Now, last I checked, by the way, Omar, Jacob DeGrom, not Latin, right?
As far as I know, no.
Right. I say that because they would break your balls about that, too. They'd be like, Omar Minaya. I mean, if your name is not Santana or Martinez or Beltran, I mean, all this guy does is, which, by the way, they're pretty good players, but all this guy does is sign Latin players. I mean, you heard some of that criticism, too.
Well, the people are going to make those comments, and you don't really pay attention to those things because, in the end, if, you know, when you're signing Hall of Famers like Pedro Martinez and guys like Beltran, you know, that's, you know, for me, anytime people make any kind of comment along those lines,
right,
you just pretty much move on from the conversation.
Right. That's Beningo, just so you know. But you're not surprised, right, Omar? I want to talk about Matt Harvey for a second because he's great. We know he's great, right? But I think you know this, that his approval rating among Met fans, not very high right now. The innings limit came down, Omar, a couple of weeks ago. Really bad timing. I think you'd even agree with that, with Scott Boras. Then, of course, he misses a mandatory meeting a couple of days ago. And I've even heard Met fans say this, Omar, that he's still the best pitcher on the team, and we love him, but he's got to go. He doesn't work here in this clubhouse. So you signed him as a young kid. Did you see any of this, quote-unquote, diva stuff with Matt Harvey early?
Well, what I saw was actually the first time I saw him was in Miami. I saw him play at Miami University one day. And what I saw was a very good, solid, well-rounded, physical body with a real good arm strength guy who was throwing 90-plus in the sixth or seventh inning, secondary pitches, curveball, sliders, and a gamer. And a guy who kind of got on the mound and basically just had great presence and attack. That's the Matt Harvey that I know. All that other stuff I can't speak about because I'm really not being there. I don't know the details of how those things happen.
That's fair, but you know the stories. You know the stories. You read it. You know, you're up on everything, Omar. If you were the GM of the Mets, forgetting about his talent for a second, you'd have to be somewhat disappointed, no?
No, well, I can't comment on things that I don't know about. You know, it's often because I've been a GM, so I know. Not knowing the background, the details of it, but I will tell you, this guy is a competitor and he's a winner.
Yeah, there's no question about that. So, listen, we both agree that DeGrom has exceeded expectations. You're very proud of him. I'll tell you who else you signed, Omar, that this year is one of the guys that should get as much credit as anybody for the Mets' success. He was forced into the closer role due to a drug suspension, and he was magnificent. I mean, Familiar, you got to be very proud of him.
Yeah, he's a kid that we saw early on in the Dominican Republic. Our scouts identify him. Guys like Ramon Pena, Ismael Cruz, and Rafael Perez showed him. And when we saw him in one of those workouts, it was a two-inning stint. But once we saw him, we definitely saw the arm strength that he continues to show. And really that arm angle that shows great deception. So, but not only that, he's just a solid, well-rounded, real good kid. And he's done a great role originally. In my understanding, he was supposed to be the eighth inning guy with Mejia being the ninth. And, you know, he just took the role and has done a great job for them.
One more guy I want to ask you about. I mean, you brought in Lucas Duda, Lagares, but Wilmer Flores, we all know when the Mets seemingly traded him in the Carlos Gomez deal, which thank God went away and the Mets got Cespedes instead. But we'll never forget how Flores reacted, Omar, crying. I mean, legitimately, literally crying, hysterical on the field after being drafted, I guess, at 16 by you. You know, he thought his days in New York were over. And to a certain extent, he's become a bit of a folk hero with us Met fans now. We love the fact that he loves our team and our organization so much. That was pretty cool to see. I know people made fun of him, but in the end, that was pretty cool to see, yes?
Well, I think it was, you're right. And I say this, and you know, not only, you know Met fans and you know New Yorkers. And one thing about New Yorkers, that can be rough, but if you're... If you show emotions and you tell people you love being a New Yorker or being from here, no matter what, That has a lot of mileage.
Yeah.
Like I said, that kid, he is definitely going to be loved in New York. And don't get me wrong, we're talking about a kid still. He's only 23 years old.
Mm.
And when you see a kid crying on TV in the middle of a game, that has to touch you. And then you got to take to yourself, oh, you know what? This guy wants to be one of us. And there's something special about him being one of us.
Yeah, and he had some big hits right after that, too. A game-winning home run just days after he was crying on the field. So, listen, I know your heart is with the Mets because, again, most of the team you drafted, you know these kids personally. But if you can take yourself out of that for a second, Omar, a very daunting task. I know Kershaw's not been great in the postseason, but he's the best pitcher on the planet, bottom line. So to face Kershaw and Greinke on the road the first two games, you don't even get to Matt Harvey till game three. I don't like that. I'd rather see Harvey in 2 and 5. That's just me. Are the Mets going to win this series?
Well, as you know, Sid, I'm with the Players Association now. So there is a history definitely with the New York Metropolitan, as we call it, some of us, you know? But being with the Players Association, what I can tell you is you could not – I mean, you're talking about two great pitching matchups starting game one and two, you know? When you have those – when you have, Greinke going, who's a Florida kid, and then you have Kershaw going – and then you got the Grom going to Harvey. You cannot beat that. And I know we've seen two great pitchers the past two nights, one against the Yankees and last night, Arrieta against the Pirates. But you are looking at the elite, probably as good as it gets in the next two nights.
Yeah.
And being with the Players Association, I have to be careful what I say.
Of course. I got you. Right. You're right. You make a very good point, though. You saw Dallas Keuchel beat the Yankees and Arrieta beat the Pirates, and now it gets even better. You know, you left the Mets, Omar, the great Omar Minaya joining us here. You went to the Expos, and the Expos, of course, are now defunct. And if you ever sat down, what's our buddy's name, Steve at ESPN, who wrote the book about the Expos?
Jonah Carey.
Right. And looked at the players, including Pedro Martinez, who you got to the Mets, Omar, who started their careers in Montreal. And the amount of Randy Johnson, Gary Carter, great players. The fact that there's no baseball in Montreal, to me, is a crime. Now, I know that Met Blue Jay series in the preseason drew a ton of people, and the conversation has started again about bringing baseball back to Montreal. They got to do that, no?
Well, I mean, that's going to be the Major League Baseball side of that, at least. And I know they have been playing some games in Montreal, some exhibition games. And they've been doing very well. And then, listen, when I was there, as you know, my experience with the Expos organization and the Expos fan base and the city of Montreal was outstanding.
Yes.
It was a great city. It loved baseball. And I have been going there for many, many years. I was there part of those and doing those, early 90s. I remember that team in 94 that should have gone to the probably potentially to the World Series, but because of the strike, it didn't play.
Right.
But I can tell you, the fan base everybody thinks of Montreal and Canada as a hockey, and let me tell you, Montreal is a great baseball town. So what's going to happen in the future, I don't know. But if there is any kind of at some point in time, I will tell you that the fan there will support baseball.
Hey, on the way out, I know you work with the Players Association. You made that point a couple of times, Omar, but it's obvious you know talent. There may not be a man alive today that knows baseball talent like you do, and I mean that sincerely, and really successful stays with the Mets, with the Expos. You want to be a GM again?
No, I'm very happy what I'm doing. I'm very excited what I'm doing. I'm working here in the Players Association. It's a great fraternity. I'm in New York. Before I came here, I was with the Padres, and I am in New York, and I'm very, very pleased and happy with what I'm doing right now.
Well, let me say this on the way out, the same way I started this conversation. A lot of the guys, you know this, you're in New York, you're a GM of a big baseball team, a basketball team. Those guys are not touchable. They're just not. And the one thing about you, Omar, was win or lose, you were always that guy. Whether it was me and Joe or Mike and the Mad Dog, you always handled yourself with a tremendous amount of class. You stared down the controversies, but the negative press in a very classy fashion. And you're always very, very good to me. So I'm really glad I had the chance to speak to you this morning. I am thrilled to death that the Mets are having success with a lot of your guys, because quite frankly, Omar, you deserve it.
Thank you very much. And like I said, hey, I remember when you listen to you on IMS and all that. And I'm very happy for you that look, what you do, you're a talent. And I think the fan base in South Florida is very happy to have you. And I can just tell you about the introduction. if you're driving to work, you have to laugh a little. And there's nothing wrong with laughing. I think that's what makes radio fun, and when you're driving or while work. And so keep up the good work, and I'm pretty sure Russ here in New York, we're all proud of you.
Thank you, Omar. God bless you, and can't wait for our next conversation, okay? You be well, buddy. Thank you.
And listen, my friend Pete, he's a class act. That's like my brother. That's my father's brother, I call.
He is, and they make a great veal parmesan, too, so you can't...
Hey, we coached together. I think we coached the Forest Hills. I think it was the one of the Jewish Center. He was the coach. And you want to see a nut coaching basketball, but that's Pete Kramer. I'll tell you that right now.
Hey, I'll tell you what. Seriously, next time you're down here and you go to dinner at Pete's place, we'll go together. I'd love to do that.
You got it, babe. All the best.
All right, Omar. Take care. There he is, the former GM of the New York Mets. And as you heard, a lot of this Met club right now comprised of his players. And that is my friend Omar Minaya. We'll take a short break. We're back right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
We love him, and that is the great Lee Corso, who I guess has a crush on Katy Perry? Give me what happened. Now, here's Katy Perry, this young, beautiful, major pop star. She's on the set a couple of weeks ago. That was the day when Mississippi upset Alabama. She rips the hat off of your head, which, of course, you have made famous. And it seemed to me, Lee, like you seemed a little pissed off there.
No, I wasn't. She took me by surprise. You know, we've done it 225 or 30 times. No one has ever touched my head. No one. And she ripped it off, and I just looked. I was startled. Yeah. You know, Katie, I found one thing. She's unique. That's for darn sure.
Yeah. She's
unique.
And she's cute, too. I mean, how to bring you back to the days when you and Burt Reynolds were pulling 2-on-1s back at Florida State, yes?
Not so fast, my friend. Oh, let's don't go there.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Dr. Ben Carson not backing down from his comments about that massacre at a community college in Oregon, saying he wouldn't just stand there. Tonight, what he's now saying when it was pointed out one hero didn't stand there, he rushed the gunman. And Carson's biggest rival, Donald Trump, coming to his defense. Here's ABC's Tom Yamas.
Tonight, Dr. Ben Carson standing firmly behind his comments, suggesting the victims in the Oregon campus massacre could have done more.
But Dr. Carson, if a gunman walks up and puts a gun at you and says, "What religion are you?" That is the ultimate test of your faith.
I would not just stand there and let him shoot me. I would say, "Hey guys, everybody attack him. He may shoot me, but he can't get us all."
Today, Carson doubling down.
From the indications that I got, they did not rush the shooter. The shooter can only shoot one person at a time. He cannot shoot a whole group of people.
But Carson didn't seem to know about Chris Mintz, the Army veteran who did and save lives, though he was shot 7 times. Carson now says Mintz did exactly what should be done. And tonight, Carson getting support from his top rival. Donald Trump, the whole Carson controversy is overblown.
I thought Ben Carson was treated, frankly, I thought he was treated very unfairly.
David, tomorrow Trump will rally here on the Vegas Strip. He owns a luxury hotel here that has windows lined with 24-karat gold, a stark difference from the other candidate who will be here, Senator Marco Rubio. When he was a boy, his mother worked on the Strip as a hotel maid.
Tomorrow's so far away, there's something I just have to say. I don't think I could hide what I've been inside another day, knowing I love you. And I'm getting too close again. I don't wanna see it end. If I tell
Well, that's the first piece of news of politics we've gotten to in a while today. Something's going on with the phones here now. What is that exactly? We had a pretty good sports one there, starting at 6:45 a.m. this morning with Matt Cerrone, who's at MetsBlog.com. Then 7 o'clock, Stu Feiner made picks on college and NFL football. Then we went right to Doug Sipu, who owns the Panthers Hockey Talk at 7:30. Then more baseball talk with former Met GM Omar Minaya at 8. So not a lot of space today for the news and politics, but plenty of that coming up, because at 9:30 we've got the host of Hardball on MSNBC, Chris Matthews, who I love dearly, and I think he's annoying, but he's great. And I sat through the hour of Hardball last night like a prisoner of war, to be honest. I mean, there's just one asshole liberal after another. But Matthews is coming on at 9:30, then Jesse Ventura at 9:50. So you got plenty of politics coming up.
Now, did Chris Matthews change his tone on Trump yet? Because I don't believe he did. I mean, he didn't endorse him, but he still likes some of his ideas.
But the piece we just paid on Ben Carson, he had I forget who was on the panel. It may have been, I sent you some of those names last night. Francisca, what is her name again?
Give
me some of those names, because I never heard of these folks.
Francesca Chambers. David Corn. Carol Lee.
Carol Lee's not bad looking.
Right.
She's pretty cute. So you had all these people sitting around just bashing Ben Carson, and it did compel me during the Cub Pirate game to tweet and Facebook, get off his ass, man. I mean, if you really believe, first of all, Ben Carson's a nice guy. He shouldn't be president. Maybe be a good VP. I don't know. He's certainly a very good Surgeon General. But I really believe he's a decent man.
Yeah.
He's a nice guy. If you really believe that he was insensitive and or really went out of his way to criticize the victims, you're an idiot. I mean, he was just giving his opinion. Now, look, very easy to say that. Go rush the shooter when you're sitting on The View or the CBS Early Show with Nora O'Donnell, or Fox in a suit and tie. Very easy to say that. Do I know if life on the line, Ben Carson would do what he said he would do? I don't know. But all he's doing is offering his opinion. That's it. His opinion on what he thinks may limit fatalities and the carnage next time. Now, look, gun owners, here's what he's talking about, okay? I mean, the truth is this guy in Oregon did not have an automatic weapon. He had a semi-automatic weapon that was his rifle, the AR-15. That was on the ground. So all he had on him was the handgun. And what Ben Carson did fail to mention, as I defend him, was that Chris Mintz, the great Marine, did in fact rush the shooter. He took 7 bullets. He's going to survive, but he may never walk again. That is a bad story. Didn't end well. He may never walk again. So there was one guy who did do that, and it didn't turn out well for him. But the truth is... that's Ben's opinion. So if you don't like it, that's fine. But to call him insensitive that's a bit much, no?
No, I agree. And we also don't know the extent of what Chris Mintz meant or what he did in this scenario. Did he jump in front of bullets and save people from dying? Did he jump in front and then the shooter ran off somewhere else and shot himself because he realized people were fighting back?
The shooter shot himself because he was injured. After the Mintz thing, there was a gun battle with police. Two officers in particular with the shooter.
Okay.
They did shoot the bad guy. He got hit in the side. And at that point, because he was exchanging gunfire with the police in an effort to maybe get out of there, once the police hit him, he then kind of crawled into another room. He was bleeding, and then he blew his brains out.
Okay. But we still don't know, and maybe Chris Mintz didn't save anyone. But chances are, if the guy took 7 shots...
It doesn't even matter. The point is whether Chris Mintz saved lives, didn't save lives, it's just Ben's opinion. And it gets so nasty out there. You know, liberals are just... oh, they're the worst. And they're just killing this guy for having an opinion.
Well, that's all it is just a jump. Because, I mean, it's such a jump to go from him just explaining, you know, what he thinks should be done or what would be a good thing to do in that situation.
What would you
do? It's such a jump.
What would you? Because even though you're muscular and one of the biggest and strongest guys I know, you are a vagina with a capital V. I mean,
I'm not going to stand up too well to a gun.
Right.
I like to think that if I was in that situation and the opportunity presented itself, I might make a move.
Right.
But...
But the odds are
maybe not. Yeah. It's tough to say when the guys. I've only had two guns pulled on me in my entire life.
Oh, here he goes. So you sound like Rich Stevens.
No, I'm just saying.
Now, where were these guns? Give me the scenarios where you had guns pulled on you.
Once in high school.
At Hollywood Hills with a bunch of Jews.
Well, we made the mistake. Me and the Hollywood Hills crew made the mistake.
Oh, the crew.
Well, just, you know.
You were the Hollywood Hills crew.
Well, on Friday and Saturday nights,
you were the guy standing outside the sip and whatever, smoking cigarettes with the Beavis and Butthead t-shirts.
It was actually the Burger King on Sheridan Street in Emerald Hills.
I know that one.
That was the hangout for Hollywood Hills. Well, we went to the hangout, unfortunately, of South Broward, which is Dania Beach and the pier.
That's the enemy. And we ran that's like the Sharks and the Jets.
Basically, that's what it was. And the guys from South Broward basically said, get out of here. We said no. And one guy pulled out a gun, and we said, okay, we're leaving. So
did he actually fire the gun into the air?
No, never, but he showed it.
And you saw the gun?
Saw the gun.
It was a real gun?
A real gun.
Wow. Did you cry?
I did not cry, but I left.
Did you crap your pants?
Didn't do that, but I did leave. It almost seemed so surreal at the moment that it didn't hit me till after.
Right, and then what was this? Because Ricky Balupe is saying he was robbed at gunpoint too. I've had a gun put to my face once. It doesn't matter why, but but you've had it twice. What was the second time?
Oh, well, I knew a girl. I was going over the visitor, and she told me
you were banging somebody else's chick.
Well, no, just I was
you
a girl
son of a,
that I
this
knew.
This is Derek Fisher and Matt Barnes all over again.
This is just a story. I knew a girl. She said, come by. I said, okay. She said her dad was not home, who happened to be a cop.
Oh, boy.
So I did go to her house. She wasn't answering the door, so I went and knocked on her bedroom window. And the only person that heard this was her dad, who happened to be home, a cop.
And he came out with a gun?
So I walked over back to the door to knock again, and the door opens, and I'm greeted by a gun right to my nose. Says, you looking for anybody? Why are you knocking on windows? And I'm like, hey, I know, her name. I gave her an I go to school with her. I'm just coming by to say hi, blah, blah, blah. And he put the gun down. But that was it. The door opened, and there was a gun right to my face.
Wow. You are like... you're a man of danger. You're like Henry Danger.
Well, those are the only two guns that I've ever seen in front of my face. Right. But like I said, it's a big jump from, okay, I would rush the guy or whatever to criticizing and criticizing the victims.
Right.
I don't think
he was doing that. Right.
No. If surely he wasn't.
Do you think he'd
really come out and go, these guys didn't handle
the
situation
right? I'm going to say he wasn't, right. I'm going to give Ben Carson the benefit of the doubt.
I think he's intelligent enough to know not to, criticize the victims.
But I will tell you, coming up in 43 minutes, the host of Hardball on MSNBC, who demands and deserves a lot of respect around the country for his political analysis, Chris Matthews, who's always great, he'll be here, and he does think that Ben Carson was insensitive to the victims. He was very tough on Ben Carson on Hardball last night, so he may piss you off at 9:30.
Well, he may.
But he talks so damn fast, Chris Matthews, and he just really can't even get in there with
him. I mean, from the pieces I've heard, I didn't hear anything that sounded like he was condemming or making light of the victims in any way or criticizing.
Well, from Ben,
the way
Ben wasn't, right?
Yeah, Ben, I didn't hear anything like that.
So in terms of baseball, because we will get back to the Ben Carson discussion, Hillary Clinton really now distancing herself from Barack Obama. Now she has flip-flopped on the trade agreement. She says, no thank you, joining the ranks of Bernie Sanders. So that's now a couple of times here that Hillary Clinton has gone the other way of Barack Obama. So there's some really good meaty stuff out there that we'll discuss with both Chris Matthews and Jesse Ventura. But getting back to baseball, way back when? In a land and a galaxy far, far away. Z-Mac made a bet. I guess it was a bet. I think didn't I make a bet too?
Yeah, it was like a friendly, yeah.
Right. Me and Z-Mac bet Tanyan Sturts. Tanyan was a very good pitcher, starting in 2004 for the Yankees. He moved down here years ago, and now he's become a very good friend of mine. He tolerates Z-Mac, and he's a good friend of the show. He's great on the show, in fact. But he's a Yankee. He'll always be a Yankee at heart, so he's misguided, delusional, and quite frankly, for a big, smart guy, stupid. Which I can say because he's on hold and about 45 miles away. So he makes a bet with Z-Mac, which is the dumbest bet you could have made, because you have to know the Yankees were old and this Yankee team wasn't going to contend, that they would have a better record, go further, blah, 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 than the Mets. And of course, much like his season in 2004 with the Yankees. Well, no, he was good, but the team took a crap. His wager took a crap, too. So he lost. But Tanyan Sturts is a man of his word. I got to give him, see, he's a Boston guy. Boston guys are like that. He's a good guy and a man of his word. So after breaking your balls incessantly and calling you all kinds of horrible
everything,
he's now lost the bet. So now he has to basically suck your pee-pee.
Well, no, I would not. It was a steak dinner.
Well, I wanted to get that second part in, but you went out.
That wasn't cool.
You're lucky he is 45 miles away.
But in true manly fashion, Sturtz has admitted he's lost. And now he's even reached out and said he'll take you to any restaurant you want. Is that not true?
Yes. Any steakhouse.
Specifically a steakhouse.
Yeah.
So we know the best steakhouse, and we love NYY Steak, and we love, that's all we really love. But the best by far is New York Prime in Boca. It's also the most expensive. And ideally, we want Tanya and Sturtz to spend some of that 2004 money. So where are you making him take you?
I say New York Prime.
New York Prime. Perfect. You taking the little piece on the side?
Yeah.
Take the kid, too. Why not? No, take Lengel's kid, too.
Maybe can Lengel come also?
Alicia? I'd like to come.
I think Tanya Sturtz, when you lose a bet to any one of us, you lose a bet to the show. So the dinner should be Sturtz.
And our significant other.
Right. Sturtz and his beautiful wife, who just had their baby son, Mookie.
Congrats.
You and Stacy.
Mookie.
Eric and Alicia and me and Danielle. That should be the dinner. That should be the dinner.
Sounds fun.
Well, let's find out from Tanya. Hi, Tanya.
I have no problem with taking your whole entourage to dinner. Okay?
Really?
You guys are like NBA players. You roll like 15 deep everywhere you go.
That's funny. Hey, how's the baby? Seriously.
Baby's good. We got a 4-hour clip in last night. Not bad.
Nice.
So we're okay.
Nice. Good.
You know?
Okay, good. That's good to hear. Well, listen, you took it like a man, I got to say. You know, you talked a lot of trash, and which Yankee fans and Yankee players do, but in the end, of course, you lost, and you've admitted that, and you've stepped up to the plate. And I've always said this about you, Tanya. I've known you now for 11 years. You're a stand-up guy and a man of your word, so that's a big deal.
I did lose. I admit that. I have no problem with admitting that, but
yes, you do. It's killing you.
I didn't know I had to come on national radio and admit it. I thought this was a Twitter war, but I guess.
Hey, it's the least you can do. If I actually go back and print out, Tanya, some of the tweets that you sent to C-Mac, you beat the living daylights out of this kid. You killed him.
Well, I told him I'd buy him a steak because that little pencil that can't eat an 8-ounce steak. So what difference does it make?
He's gonna get the biggest steak in the place. You know that too.
Yeah, no doubt, no question. That's all right.
But on a serious note, forgetting about C-Mac and the bet. On a serious note, you're a Yankee. I mean, there's nothing more proudful in New York sports and being a New York Yankee, and to lose a bet, forget about Z-Mac, to lose a bet because of the Mets when you're a Yankee, that's a killer, right? It's a killer.
Yeah, it hurts. It still hurts. That's what I was trying to hide. You guys kept blowing my phone up yesterday. I was trying to hide for a couple of days. Drowning this sorrow.
Now, what will you do? Because you're a New Yorker, too, now. I know you live here, and you grew up in Boston, but there's a part of you that will always be loved and revered, and a lot of guys in New York still love you. So will you root against the Mets, against the Dodgers?
No. Of course not. No. But it's hockey season, so now I'm on to hockey.
Now you're into the Bruins?
Yeah, now I'm on to the Bruins.
Are you?
Listen, this is what I was thinking. I know you guys want to bring your whole entourage to dinner, but I say we do dinner, right, and then maybe we pick like a good Panthers game. Someone good comes in town, and we go see the game for a couple periods, and we beat it.
Why don't we just go? Being that I'm best friends with the owners, and you're a big time Yankee player anyway, why don't we just go to a Panther Bruins game?
Oh, that would be great. I mean, I know you guys are Ranger fans. I thought maybe you guys want to see the Rangers.
No.
It's your night. I lost the bet. I lost the bet, so it's your night.
You know what? I made this admission on the air today, Tanya, which did bother a lot of my New York listeners. I have a lot of New York listeners. They tweeted this, that I am no longer a Ranger fan first after 48 years, being that I'm so close with Vinny and Doug, who own the Panthers. I'm Panthers first, Rangers second. So the Bruins works for me. We'll take you to see Boston.
Well, then maybe we'll go down and see them, and we'll try to have them try to convert me, too. How about that?
What, you think there's a – well, your kids have to be Panther fans because they're growing up here, no?
Yeah, definitely.
But are you convertible? Is there a chance – if I went from Rangers to Panthers, can Sturtz go from Bruins to Panthers?
It took you a long time, though.
Right.
I mean, right.
Yes, it took me a long time.
I mean, this is going to be a work in progress. Probably like a couple seasons – couple seasons going into the owner's box. You know what I mean?
Exactly how they treat you goes a long way. Did the Bruins play last night?
No, I don't think so.
They didn't play last night?
I watched the Chicago game for a while.
That's the Ranger game.
Yeah, I watched that game. It was a good game.
Yeah, that was a good game. So what happens now with the Yanks? You know, do you know CC?
I do know CC. Yeah, I know CC
so
very well.
When that story came down that he needed alcohol rehab a couple of days ago, what were you thinking?
I was thinking it takes a very big man to be able to come out and to admit that, especially at a time when it was playoff time. I know a lot of people gave him crap for it, but, I mean, obviously something had to be completely off for someone to admit it like that and take responsibility and go get it taken care of.
I feel the same exact way. I really do, and I was surprised by the amount of Yankee fans, Tanyan, that were really pissed. I mean, CC wasn't going to pitch that day anyway. It was
right.
It was
Tanaka.
I don't
even think he was on the playoff roster for the first series anyway, so I think that was one of the main reasons why he said, I got to go get this taken care of now. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I can't put words in his mouth. But, I mean, honestly, if you have a problem that you understand is that big and you know that you have to go get help for it, I mean, that's a huge step for him.
I agree. No, that step one is the biggest. And I know this, Tanya, because, again, you know him and you're friendly with him. As far as I know, getting back to his days in 2009 when he was the ace and that team won the World Series, there are very few guys, if any, more popular in that clubhouse than Sabathia, right?
No, listen, one of the best guys in the game.
Really?
And there's a lot of people that will back that up and say the same thing, but he is one of the nicest and one of the best guys that you could ever be around.
Wow. How about that? So what do you think, you know, moving forward, talk about the Mets and the Yankees. I mean, even you know this. The Mets are young, man. These kids, these arms are young and great. You look at the Yankees, you ain't getting 60 home runs next year from A-Rod into Teixeira. I mean, what the hell is Brian Cashman going to do this offseason?
I heard your little talk with Mad Dog yesterday.
Right.
Don't try to backdoor me with all this stuff. Okay?
But it's a fair question, no?
I listen. You know, I drive my daughter home from school, and I turn you guys on. I don't know why I turn you on, but I turn you on. You know, but listen, I agree. It is it's a big question. They got a lot of things that they have to work out. And Mad Dog was completely right. I mean, the Ellsbury deal I thought was horrible, and I thought the Headley deal was horrible. Yeah. It really ties up a lot of stuff. And I mean, look at this stock. There's nothing they can do about it. I mean, really can't.
No. You know? Did you know Doggy, Mike and the Dog, when you up in New York when you pitched for the Yanks? Did they have you on?
I only met him a couple times. He was, Mike and the Mad Dog show back then?
Yeah.
So I only met him a couple times. I think I met him at Joe Torre's golf tournament a couple times.
Oh, of course
they did.
Absolutely.
Do that. Yeah.
So you played in that one, the one at Trump International with the Safe at Home Foundation?
Yes. Yeah, cool. It was great. Yeah. Yep.
I was there last year, actually. I actually did a show for FAN from there, and Tino was there, and Coney. And
he puts on a great tournament. It's a great time.
He really does. All right. Well, listen, are you playing golf this morning?
No.
What?
Not today. Listen, you guys got to let me plug something today. You know, I never plug anything, but my company is about to be ready to come out. I've been waiting to tell you guys this. So testdrive.com is my new company. It's going to come out at the end of the month. It's going to change the way people buy cars. And you can go on the website, fool around a little bit, check it out, and hopefully at the end of the month I'll come back on and we'll talk a little more about it once it launches.
All right, so it's testdrive.com, and they sell tires?
No, cars.
Oh, cars.
Test drives for cars.
Okay, and then what kind of car are we talking about? Exotic cars? Fancy cars?
No.
What kind of cars?
No exotic cars. Cars like Toyotas, Hyundais, you know, so we're just going to go to the main.
Well, let me ask you this, Tanyan. Why would I, other than the fact that I love you, you're my friend, so I will go there, but if I'm not a big Yankee Tanyan Sturts fan, why am I going onto testdrive.com and not walking into some Toyota or Honda dealership here in South Florida?
Well, because a lot of people don't want to walk around the dealership. So right now what we'll do is we'll set up a test drive for you. Say you want to go get a test drive at Toyota Camry at 2 o'clock. That Toyota Camry will be sitting out front Toyota Boca at 2 o'clock with a guy in the passenger seat, and you guys go and take a ride.
That's fair.
You decide whether you like the car or not.
Actually, I kind of like that a lot. That sounds like you may have great success with this.
Yeah, that way there you don't have to walk around the dealership looking and listening to
somebody chirping your ear and stuff like that. It's already set up. You want a black Toyota Camry with tan interior. That car's sitting out front of Toyota Boca, and you take it for a ride.
Test
and you decide whether you want to.
Testdrive.com, right?
Testdrive.com. That's
awesome.
Right.
Yeah, you'll come back on. We'll promote it for you, and then I'll set it up with the Panthers when the Bruins are in town, Tanyan, and that'll be the night that we do the dinner and the hockey game and all that good stuff. Sound good?
Sounds perfect. Bring your entourage, all your 15 guys that you like to hang out with.
I'm not going
to
bring 15. That would be very Gavonish of me. I'm bringing 11, okay?
Hey, don't bring Eric. That is too big, man. He'll eat like 12 steaks.
You don't even know. You're so right. He is coming, just so you know, and he's taking his kid.
Jesus. Oh, Jesus. How big is this kid? 7'2", 240?
He's not like him. He's not like him. But he does eat like he's got two or three assholes. So get ready to bring the black card, okay?
You got it. You got it.
We love
you,
Tom.
See you guys.
All right.
Have a good day.
You too. He's our favorite baseball player.
He's a man.
He is the baseball player. He's the baseball player for the show.
100%.
Tanyan Sturts.
100%.
He's the Sid Rosenberg Show baseball guy.
Testdrive.com. I got to check it out.
Check it out. All right. So, excellent run here so far. Not nearly done. Again, 9:30, the host of Hardball on MSNBC, Chris Matthews. And not long after him at 9:50, the very controversial former governor of Minnesota, big-time wrestler, Navy SEAL, Tampa Bay Buccaneer football announcer. You name it, he's done it all. Jesse Ventura, 844-640-6464, 844-640-6464. Back with the 9 o'clock hour and a couple of great guests right after this.